lunch, and we can eat, and we can fellowship a little bit more. Good to have you with us tonight. Tomorrow is Sister Bill's birthday, and she's not here for us to sing yet, but when she gets here, we'll sing to her. Happy birthday. But right now, we can go ahead and start eating and have a good time and fellowship a little bit. In your program tonight, make a reference to an article in Pentecostal Life magazine. I'm sorry, we have a lot more of these when I got ready to do this, but there's only four left and things, so that means y'all must pick some up Sunday, which is good. On page 34, we're going to do a little bit of talking about an article entitled Forgiveness and Fumes. When I saw this magazine cover, I thought, boy, that is strange. Strange thing. It looks like an automotive kind of magazine or something, but it's talking about an exhaust system for an engine. Without an exhaust system, it won't function right. And so forgiveness is your exhaust system. So that's what I'm going to talk about tonight. Other things that you're going to talk about that as well. But right now, let's pray, shall we? And ask the Lord just to bless the food. And we can just enjoy it, and we'll pick that back up. Shall we pray? Lord Jesus, we're grateful and thankful for your love, your mercy, your goodness, and your tenderness toward us. Thankful, Lord, for our friends who have gathered tonight under the banner of your name. We pray that you would grace this place and this table with your presence. We pray that you'd open our hearts to understand the word. We pray that you would strengthen our resolve to do the things that are right for your kingdom. We thank you, Lord, for the word, for the spirit, and for your people. We ask tonight that you would just add your blessing to everything that's done, and we will give you the praise. For the food, we give you thanks ahead of time. We know it's good, but we're thanking you for it. Bless it to our bodies. Nourish us, and we'll give you the praise on the second measure. In Jesus' name, everybody said amen. Praise amen. God. Okay, if you're hungry, help yourself. Tonight, as you know, we usually spend a little time sharing and talking, and it's free open talking. Everybody can share. The new format of the Pentecostal Life magazine has a section in there for Bible study discussion groups. We've never tried to take advantage of that. There's four of them. In fact, I just got through writing one to come out for Thanksgiving. But anyway, that's what I want to talk about a little bit tonight. I did not like the cover of the magazine when I saw it. I thought it looked like an automobile magazine, something. So I didn't have any relationship to it until I just looked at it and saw, what is that on there for? Then when I got the article in it, smack again, when they helped me tie it together. Her husband is the presbyter, or he's the superintendent of the Illinois district, and she has a degree in counseling, so she's well prepared to write this article. Basically, the article says, and I didn't have enough, I thought I'd have more magazines. It's on page 34, if you got one in front of you there. Probably have more to share with you about tonight because they disappeared, which is good because we mentioned that. Basically, it says that God has built an exhaust system into everything that He's created. Your physical body is no different than anything else in creation. So it's this principle of you can only get more in this hand as you're willing to release this hand of what you got in it. So if you just breathe in and don't ever exhale, you can only breathe in so much. You gotta have an exhale somewhere or you're just not gonna be able to have it. I can't do that with once. So anyway, the article takes the automobile engine as just an example of that because it will not function without an exhaust.
What's
the exhaust of the Tesla? The exhaust of Tesla is the First National Bank of California. Because all the money he makes goes into that, and he is so happy when you buy his cars. I don't know. What is the exhaust of Tesla?
Heat.
Heat is the exhaust of Tesla. Y'all all knew that, didn't you? Except me. Y'all know what he's talking about, don't we? He said Tesla. That's not
Electric car.
You seen these little electric car charger places? The Denny's? Those are owned by Tesla. So you can go there and charge your electric car while you're getting a Denny burger. Anyway, I did not know that. But it has to have an exhaust system. Whatever it is, it has to have. So they that's me. So in the latter part of the article, she has three things to talk about. One is forgiveness is an act of the will. The second thing is forgiveness is an act of the heart. And the third thing is forgiveness is only complete when there's reconciliation. So her exhaust system, she says that God's exhaust system for the human body, spirit, soul, and mind, is forgiveness. So when you get into Matthew and you talk about the four principles, first of them is giving, second is prayer, third one is fasting, and the last one is treasure, but forgiveness is attached to your prayer. And what the Lord said in that four principles is, if you don't forgive, neither will your Heavenly Father forgive you. So when you do not forgive, you block the exhaust system so that your system cannot take in the forgiveness of God. Isn't that interesting? So she says it has to do things. First of all, it has to be a determined part of the will. Determined part of the will. Sister Hope and I looked at a film the other night on forgiveness of a man in California that his wife and daughter were killed in a car wreck by a teenage boy that was racing, lost control, hit this car, and killed the mother and the daughter of this man and two other sons. And so he was up for 30 years in prison. This man began to think about this, so he asked if he could have a one-on-one meeting with this boy. So he met with this boy and said, I just want to talk to him without lawyers, without anybody else, just me and him. I want to hear what this boy's got to say. When he talked to the boy, he realized that there was contrition on his part. He didn't deliberately go out and try to kill anybody, but he's a teenage kid, he did the wrong thing. Somebody died. Make a long story short, when they were ready for the sentencing stage, he asked the judge if the judge would release him from all responsibility, including a felony charge, if he would be willing to go to high schools in California and tell his story of what he did, how much grief it brought to him, that destroyed his life and 7 or 8 to 10 other people's lives. And so that boy agreed to do that instead of going to prison for 30 years. And he's still doing that today in high schools in California. And the man lost his wife, goes with him. He just simply introduces him. The boy tells his story. And they hope that it's helped save a lot of lives from kids who don't think how dangerous it is to get behind the wheel of a car. So the first one is an act of the will. You choose to forgive. It's not going to be easy to forgive because it's not the natural thing. The natural thing is get even. The natural thing is I'm suffering, you're going to suffer more. That's the natural thing. So you choose to forgive. And the second thing, you forgive has to be a matter of the heart, not just of the mind. For you to have the release that you need. The third thing she talks about is reconciling. So when we truly forgive and it's an act of the heart, what we're trying to do is repair that as much as possible so that it is no longer there. So it's a big issue. Forgiveness is a big issue. And it's not always easy, but it is always essential. Jesus made the level of essentiality when he said that you are cut off from my forgiveness when you refuse to forgive. So what we do is we block up in our system, we block up in our minds and our hearts that which we absolutely are not going to change. We're going to hold that hatred. So we lock God out. Lock him out. So that's the article. And so I'm just open for your questions. I remember the first time I ever really had to experience this. And it was a teenage boy in my church when I was a kid growing up. He hurt me with a girl that I was related to, going with at the time. I had to experience an intimate interest. Teenagers experience things, but you have to get through those, put it behind you, forgive them, and go on. And that man became a, you know, like all this group. But in adults, sometimes we battle it to the point that we want to make sure that they suffer for what they did wrong. What was it that Joseph said to his brothers? You meant it for? What the scripture says is you thought it for evil, but God meant it for good. That's the way the scripture says it. You thought it for evil, but God meant it. In other words, you think God was behind them doing what they did? Or was God able to take the circumstances and turn them around? So, it's open for discussion. Any comments about that or anything else in the book that you want to talk about? Praise God. It's open.
Well, there's an Indiana, my neighbor. He's an older fellow, probably in his 90s now. And I always respect him a lot. I love him to death. But he was saying one time, he was telling me, he said, I saw something about, you know, pillars and this. You know, I'm like, okay, cool. And he said, it hit him when he read that where Jesus says, you know, and where they ask him, you know, do I got to forgive 7 times?
Yeah.
And he says, 70 times 7, you know, 490, you know. And Brother Wells said, he said, you know, it hit me what that means. He goes, you forgive somebody for something, but then later when you see that person, you think about it again, and you got to forgive it over in your mind.
That's right.
And for a long time, you got to just forgive that over in your mind because your flesh wants you to rise up against it, but you got to keep your flesh under and keep forgiving that over and over in your mind. He said, I don't think that means somebody can get away with doing something 490 times to you, but you're going to think it over and over. You know, and I think that would be a point.
I think it's got an interesting point there. Interesting. Is there anybody in here that nobody's ever offended you? We need to talk to you if that's the case. Everybody in here, everybody loves you, everything you do, everybody's 100% behind you, that's just the way it is. Anybody here ever had anybody that cross you just a little bit? Good. I think you got a comment for the microphone.
We all know the verse where Jesus says, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they've done.
Yes.
And as I was looking at it, the free version I have automatically goes to the ISD. I don't know what that stands for.
International Standard Version.
Okay. It says, Jesus kept saying, Father, forgive them because they don't know what they're doing. Then they divided his clothes among them and throwing dice. But it gives the impression that this is something, not just one phrase, but as he's dying, he's saying over and over again, over and over again. So I don't know where they're getting that, but the other ones, when I look it up, it does come from a different word. First off, then said is a different phrase than what's normal. But it's a repetition, it seems. As maybe as every time he hurts, he says it again, or whatever. I'd like to know in the spirit world what process was happening, because I believe his prayer definitely got answered, and how that was taken off their record. As she goes down the list, true forgiveness, you have to have confrontation. The third one, reconciliation. For the relationship to be repaired and restored, of course, this is death, there must be confirmation and repentance by the one who has wronged. And we don't know if that ever happened. We don't know if the Sanhedrin ever repented of what they'd done. But Jesus seems to be giving forgiveness right there, despite whether or not they accept it. I think there's a differentiation between what's in their heart being wrong and the action that they had been wrong. We kind of had a little discussion at the table. If I commit a crime, and when it comes time for court, the person that I've offended says, no, just, I don't want to press charges. Well, you know, if they're an adult, in most cases, that means it's over. Even though there definitely was something wrong. And I'm wondering if that's kind of what's happening here when Jesus says, forgive them. On the record books of heaven, whatever, what has actually happened, the crucifixion is not being connected to the Jews. However, what is in their heart to cause it is still there. And if we take that and then look, and I don't know the answer to these questions, we take that and then we say, okay, what about Stephen in Acts chapter 7? When he's dying, he says, Lord, forgive them. Did God forgive them? They're not asking for forgiveness. Stephen's asking God for forgiveness. Paul hears it. Does it make a change in Paul to hear that? So forth.
You know, maybe one of the greatest Christian testimonies that you'll ever have is when somebody watches you when you're being doing wrong and you return back goodness for that wrong. That's a testimony of pure Christianity. Pure Christianity. Good. Lots of comments. Is forgiveness easier as you get older or harder? Children have spats to make up before you and the parents get involved. They already made that plan together. You and the parents start fighting with each other because Johnny hit by Susie. And we need to straighten this all out. Johnny and Susie are out there swinging again. And we're in here carrying on the debate.
Right?
Is it easier for a child to make up than it is for an adult?
I think we have more numerous occasions to have to do it.
Possibly.
The same with those that are aged. Really can't take care of themselves.
Is it hard for you to lose a child in the Pacific during the war and then see General MacArthur take over the rebuilding of Japan? Is it hard for you to see thousands of boys die in Europe and see the Marshall Plan of the United States rebuild Europe? What does that say about us as a country? As a people. That's the Christian base of this nation. People who were our enemies in war have become some of the strongest allies of us 30 years later, 40 years later. Somebody had to do some forgiving. Anybody else? The Bills, do they do any forgiving in Tennessee, or has that all just been shipped down to Texas?
Yeah, forgive all the time in Tennessee.
Brother Ferris.
Brother Bowden. Last 2 days, I've had really, really a hard time with this offender in prison. We had to put him on constant direct because I found him 3 times yesterday hanging.
Now tell them what constant direct means.
He was talking about death threat. Constant direct is meaning you're constantly watching him, somebody, 24 hours. We've got a little open window that we sit and we watch him through there to make sure he stands up. We write he stands up, he lays down. So they sleep most of the time. But this guy would just cuss you and scream and holler. So today we carried him to Skyview, which is a Rust State Hospital. But he was asked me, what are you saying? I was sitting right there. I didn't know his wife. And I said, I'm praying. He said, why are you praying? I said, I'm praying for you. And then he got a little quiet. And he said, oh, you really? And I said, yeah. And you know, he calmed down. We had a very decent day until they carried him out, but I was the only one here that let him out of that cell. All the captains around, the lieutenants, the captains, take him by one and lead him out. So I lead him out. And he's in chains and stuff like that. You know, if you folks could just see some of the things that this, if the world could just see what the drugs and things does to people's minds, you know, they wouldn't even, I don't know that they'd even take an aspirin. You know? It's scary. It really is. To know that they're so mood swings, you know, and then everybody says to me that, why are you in such a good mood all the time and laughing? And I said, I just keep crying. But anyway, you know, God is good and he's given me that opportunity to be able to just be a little bit of joy and glory that they might can see in somebody and an individual. Because, hey, I got to work with a lot of folks that work with me that cusses them and talks over them and treats them bad too, you know? And it's not the right way to do it.
Yeah. That's the difference in a Christian perspective and a non-Christian perspective. And that's who you are. So it doesn't make any difference whether it's a fellow or whether it's your next door neighbor or whoever it is. You treat them with the same respect. They're a person. Because Jesus didn't classify us, we were all sinners, all need the grace of God to take our lives. But when you see it from that level, you see the end result.
Yes.
And a lot of people don't see the end result. They just see it. So let's switch gears here just a little bit. How do I develop the spirit of forgiveness within me? How do I do that? What process has to take place so that I can accomplish it?
I think you need to do a comparison. Lord, what do you have to forgive me of? What do I have to forgive others of?
That's the start.
It goes together. Do I really want forgiveness? Is there anything I'm willing to grudge, I'm willing to hold on to go to hell for? No.
Tell them we'll forgive them for calling you in the middle of this meeting. Go ahead. So, we start with the comparison. Put yourself in Christ's stead. Did he have to forgive us? Did he have to come? Was he mistreated because he loved us? Yes. What's the second step? How do I create? What about predetermining will? I made up my mind what I'm going to do before I get to that point. If somebody sasses me, have y'all ever gone to the store and somebody butted in line in front of you? So what do you do? Hey, buddy, I was here first.
Amen.
That's right. What happens if you step back and say, excuse me, sir?
It probably depends on what kind of day you had before that happened.
So yeah. That's and that is true.
What you say first can change really quick from what you're going to say next, depending on how they respond.
Oh, yeah.
You say, excuse me, sir, and then they look back at you, what? How are you going to respond then?
We stopped to eat on the way home today. And so we got our order in and got our drinks, and we're going over to the drink machine. And two Whataburger employees were standing at the drink machine. One of them called out, the other one was just standing there talking to her right in front of the drink machine. And they had no clue that I was standing behind them waiting to get some ice. So when I said, hey, get out of the way, kids!
Then they walk back and fix your hamburger.
So that shot my hamburger had lots of mustard on it. But you know, they're totally in their world of their iPhone, not realizing that there's two elderly people standing behind them. They're old and decrepit and they need to be able to get to that. How do you handle things like that? Salt word does what? Salt word does what? Salt word does what?
Turns away wrath.
Praise God. So if I say, excuse me, please. Oh, I'm sorry, I didn't see you there. Well, that's a compliment. I'm so thin. I was there when, you know, or I'm quiet and nice. They're part of their own world. So, sister, now that you've had a bad day and it happens, how do you go about correcting it?
You should always pray before you say anything. Now, do we all always pray before we say anything? That's better than counting 10.
It's easier to talk about it in this room than to do it in real life, isn't it? Because people are not always courteous and Christian. Sometimes they're just downright evil and mean and enjoy exercising their authority. And if nothing more than saying, get out of my way.
I was coming out of Walmart. We had a female police officer. This has been many years back. And this young teenager, and she was talking to him. And he was so rude. He was cussing. She was trying to be kind. Mm-hmm. Standing there in uniform. was cussing, and I had just had about all. And so finally, he just turned around and stomped off, and she just watched him go. So I walked up to the officer. Now, I know that you guys had to put up with it sometimes, but, you know, if you need a witness that he just cursed to be able to do something, I'll be that witness. She said, that was my son.
I had a customer call me one time yelling at us because we forgot a piece of his food. He lived 45 minutes away, and I have no problem settling your issue, but if you're going to talk to me like that, I can't be on the phone anymore. And it's funny, when you correct somebody and let them know, hey, you're not handling this right, they turn it around. Because from that moment on, he was completely different in the way he communicated with me.
Absolutely.
So sometimes people don't even realize how brash they're being or how much they're coming across because they've got so much on their plate weighing them down, then you push a button, and all of a sudden all that explodes back on you. Sometimes how you respond to that will determine how they're going to respond further.
So the evil thought process, I venom on you and get it out of my system. So I just tell you all, I'll just put you in your place, and then I'll be scot-free. I feel good because I told you all. Doesn't quite work in the Christian example, though. So you and I don't have that choice, do we? If we're going to be Christian, you're going to have to be Christian and do what's the right thing to do. Amen. You know, it comes about in many, many little ways. With patience, we talked about that last week, we do possess our souls. And patience sometimes isn't easy to go. Anybody else? You remember the last time you got frustrated? Got aggravated? If you predetermine something, what you're going to do in a situation, then the decision is already made. For example, I have predetermined that I'm not going to the boats in Shreveport. That decision is already made. I don't have to do that when somebody says, come on, Brother Bowman, let's go. Well, it's good. It's good entertainment. You don't have to do anything. Just go. No, I've already determined it. That's off my list. So I don't have to make that decision under pressure. So when you know something is right, predetermine what you're going to do. And that saves you having to make that decision on the spot when you're under pressure. And you can always say, no, I can't do that. You know what we used to teach our children? You make them do this too. Sometimes children get caught by other children. And so we taught our children that if you're under pressure like that, you just simply tell them, I need to talk to my parents about that. And when they come and talk to the parents about that, we would tell them, no, you can't do that. And they would go back and say, my parents said, no, I can't do that. They got them off the hook when they didn't know what to do. When you forgive somebody, you take the load on yourself. That helps. Now y'all can exhale.
I learned early in life to forgive because I had 9 brothers and sisters.
I
learned early to how to handle forgiveness.
I was a baby 2 or 6, so you learn to forgive. My brother, I had to sit in the middle of the 2 brothers, a bench seat. We had our house dinner table, had a bench seat for the boys and 3 chairs for the girls, and so I had to slide in the middle of the bench seat. And my oldest brother used to sit down and do that.
Brothers, one of them worked with a telephone company. He came from work one day, and my brother was asleep, and he had his legs laying over on this iron bed. And he worked with a telephone company, and he had got one of these crank telephones. And he said, I wonder if this thing works, you know. So he hooked the wires to that bed still, and my brother's legs was laying over there. And when he hit that thing crank, my brother's, I promise his hair's just stuck out like this here. When it shocked him and he come off that bed, when he hit it again, well, Charles hit it again, you know. Best fight I've ever seen in my life.
Those phone systems just still get their way, don't they?
They sure do.
Okay, if you need to forgive somebody, just go ahead and do it. If you need to think about it, make it short. Let's pray and thank the Lord. Lord Jesus, we pray, Lord, that we would be examples of who you are wherever we are. As Lord, you would guide us. Give us the strength. Give us the wisdom. Give us the grace wherever we need to be. Be like you. And we will give you the praise. In Jesus' name. Everybody said amen.
Amen.
And if you said amen, you can go back to the dessert table.